Our scripture comes from the book of Ephesians, so I invite you to turn to the first chapter, if you brought your Bibles, to the first chapter of Ephesians. So I've been preparing for this reading. Are you ready for it? I'll give it my best shot. Are you ready for the reading? It's from Ephesians. Did I mention that? Okay. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless before him. Oh, I didn't do very good. He destined us as adoption as children through Jesus Christ, according to his good pleasure of his will, to the praise and glorious grace he freely bestowed upon us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and insight. He has made known to us the mystery of his wills according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to gather all things together in him, things in heaven and on earth. In Christ we have also obtained that inheritance, having been destined according to the purposes of his will, according to all things, according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were first to set our hope on Jesus Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were marked with the seal of his promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards the redemption of God's own people to the praise of God's glory.
I'm sorry, Pastor, I don't think I've got it.
You didn't
get
it?
Could you do that again?
No. You could have been. Have you ever known somebody that was so excited he couldn't get a word in edgewise? Have you? The words just start flowing out. You can't get a word in. Well, Paul's just like that. You see, in Greek, that passage is all one sentence. There's no punctuation. Gail, what do they call it? They call that a run-on, don't they? Yeah, it's one giant run-on, and I want to suggest that Paul, or perhaps he had a scribe writing for him, was so excited that he just kept saying word after word after word after word. And we know what he's excited about. It's Jesus. Just look at the different images there. He says that Jesus has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. That Jesus has chosen us. God has chosen us in Jesus Christ before the foundation of the world. In Jesus, we've been adopted as God's children. Indeed, in Jesus, we've received redemption. Now, the forgiveness of our trespasses in Jesus is all of God's wisdom and insight. The mystery of God's will is in Jesus Christ. In Christ, we've obtained an inheritance, Paul said. He's accomplished everything through Jesus for you and for me. He has sealed us in Jesus, and he's given us the Holy Spirit in Jesus. Paul is so jacked up on Jesus that he doesn't know to put a comma or a period in. Well, last week we took a look at J is for justice, remember? This week we're going to do R. R is for redemption. I couldn't take all of them, so Paul is at least partly excited about redemption. And we find it in verse 7. Paul says these words. He said, in Christ we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. And then he mentions our redemption again in the last verse. We'll start on verse 13. It says, in Christ you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people to the praise of his glory. Paul is reminding you and me that we're redeemed right now. In verse 7, he says, in Christ, we have redemption through the blood of Jesus. It's a done deal. We have it now. Through Christ, we possess it now. But then he goes on in verse 14 to remind us that it's something in the future as well. As he says, we've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. The image there in the ancient world, if you owned something, you would often put your mark on it. With cattle, we sometimes brand them. Well, there was a signet ring that was used for almost anything, and we have the seal. It was a seal that we, in the ancient day that it belonged to the owner. Well, we're sealed with the Holy Spirit. We belong to the owner, and he's the down payment for what's to come. So there's a future element to redemption. So we need to distinguish between, I think, redemption and salvation. Salvation is a broader concept. It covers almost everything. But redemption has to do what is done on our behalf. It has to do with the means of salvation, how God brings that about, how salvation comes about, how it's attained, how it's accomplished. In fact, the simplest definition of redemption is this: to buy back. That's redemption. You can think of the New Testament. Wasn't unusual if a slave was sold and the owner wanted to purchase them back. That was the word used there, was redeemed. Bought back somebody from slavery. In the Old Testament, remember the kinsman redeemer? Remember, you were supposed to keep property and individuals within the family. If families had difficulty and hardships and somebody was sold into slavery, it was the obligation of the first family member, the kinsman, to buy them back. That's the image there, to be redeemed. So synonyms for redemption would be something like this. It would be rescue, liberation, or deliverance. And wasn't Israel's whole story about deliverance? What is the story that they never tired of telling? Once we were slaves, but now we are free. How were they set free? Through God's deliverance. That is redemption. Paul is reminding you and me that Christmas just isn't about Christmas carols and babies and mangers. He's reminding you and me that Jesus is about redemption. In fact, Christians have debated how that looks, how it works. Some have said, well, what's occurring here is we have a cosmic battle between the forces of good and the forces of evil. There's a spiritual battle around us. God and the devil, and Jesus in his weakness conquers the forces of evil and sets us free, redeems us. So that's one image Christians have used. Others have said, well, maybe it has something to do with the law. Right? We know that the law requires consequences. Needs to be fulfilled. The law does when it's broken. God's law is perfect. So no imperfect human can fulfill the requirements of the law. So God sent his son, who was perfect, and he perfectly fulfilled the law. So someone said, that's what redemption is about. The perfect fulfillment of the law. Jesus taking our punishment or the consequences of our actions. Other Christians have said, well, maybe it doesn't have so much to do with that, but it has to do with Jesus as our example. We live in a dark world. And when you're in darkness, you can't find your way. So what do we need? We need somebody to come and show us the way. In fact, even lead us. So they said, maybe that's what redemption is all about. It's about Jesus showing us the way. Jesus leading you and me out of sin, out of death. That is how Jesus redeems you and me. Now, all of these are an attempt to describe something that one image can't fully capture. And that's why Christians have never said one of these views of Jesus' work is orthodox. Christians have allowed others to talk about Jesus' redemption with all of these images, because each one covers a part of that redemption, but it doesn't capture it in whole. Well, the one reminds us that there is a cosmic battle, isn't there? Between good and evil all around us. With what we've seen in California, with ISIS and other places, can any of us deny that there's a spiritual battle going on? And they remind us that Jesus defeated the forces of evil through the foolishness of the cross. We're also reminded that we're all sinners and we can't stand before a sinless God. We all do not fulfill the law, and so we can't stand before the judge. It reminds us of that. We all know that we need an example in our world. We need somebody to show us the way. See, all these images describe what Jesus did in different ways, but they all agree on this one point. Jesus did for you and for me, for the entire world, what we can't do in our own strength. He redeemed each of us. Yea, the whole world, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. All of these views of God's work fall strongly on this truth. Jesus does for you and for me what we can't do on our own, in our own righteousness. little two-year-old, a little second-grade boy was asked by his teacher. She said, I want you to complete this sentence. Cleanliness is next to... He said, impossible. See, it's impossible for us to please God. It's impossible to totally be clean, right? And especially if you're a little boy. It's impossible for us in our own righteousness to please God. That's why we need a Redeemer. That's why we need Jesus. We talked about that last week. Remember, we all live in this, on the horns of a dilemma. On the one hand, we all have this deep sense of what we ought to do. And yet, on the other hand, when we're honest, we all have to admit we don't live up to our own standards, do we? I don't know about you, but I don't. That's why I have to tell my children, do as I say, not as I do. Because I don't live up to my own standards, let alone God's standards. So we're on this horn of the dilemma. And redemption is about God has bridged that gap. I no longer have to live up to the ought because Jesus has done it on my behalf. That's what redemption is all about. That's why we need Jesus. He becomes our representative. He stands in for us. He saves us. He redeems us. That's redemption. I shared this story at Doug Fargo's funeral. It was one I came back to. I read it a number of years ago. It's the story of John Muir. How many of you are familiar with John Muir? He was a 19th century conservationist. Thank God for John Muir, because we have most of our national parks because of his hard work. If he wouldn't have had the foresight to say we need to set land aside, it probably would have all been developed. He was one who fought for that. Well, he traveled the country over when it was a frontier land, and one time he was up in Alaska, and he came to a Native American tribe, and much to his surprise, almost to an individual, they had accepted Jesus Christ. They were all Christians. He said, well, this doesn't make sense. So he gathered some of the elders, and he said, well, why are you all Christians? And they shared this story. They said, well, 30 years ago or so, we had been in an ongoing battle with our neighboring tribe. It went on and on. We would kill some of their folk, and then they would retaliate. It just went on year after year, and finally there was one severe summer of fighting, and we reached the end of it, and we realized that if we didn't stop fighting and collect food for the upcoming winter, we were all going to starve. So we went to them and said, let's stop fighting. We're going to die if we don't. And the leaders of the other tribe responded with these words. They said, we cannot stop, because you have killed 10 more warriors than we have. Give us 10 of your men and we will make peace. At that point, one in their delegation stood up and he said, you know that I am the chief. I'm the chief of our tribe. I'm worth 10 men. Take me so that the score can be settled and the fighting can stop once and for all. So that's what they did. They took the chief, and in the presence of all of them, they was put to death, and the fighting stopped. Even as an unbeliever, Muir was amazed. He was overcome by the act of that chief. He couldn't believe it. He was awestruck. That's just a small picture of the redemption of Jesus Christ. That's why they received Jesus Christ with open arms, because they had saw Jesus embodied in their chief. And so when the good news of Jesus came about his redemption, they all became Christians and said, if that's what our God is about, we want that God that you bring. Chuck Colson once put it this way. He said, all the kings in history sent their people out to die for them. Jesus was the only king who died for his people. How many of us have seen the tragedy of San Bernardino? Absolutely horrendous. But how many have recently seen the story of one of those workers who, during the shooting, grabbed a hold of his co-worker and said, I got you. And there gave his life up for her. That's what God says to you and to me and all of us. I got you. I got you. I can do what you can't do, what you're powerless to do. I've got you. I've got you. That's the story of redemption. J is for justice, but R is for redemption. And if that doesn't give us pause, if that doesn't strike us as profound, if that doesn't cause us to get a little excited about what God has done for us, folks, we need to shut the doors and quit worshiping. That is the work of Jesus Christ on your behalf and my behalf. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Lord, as Christmas approaches and so many things distract us, when we think of Jesus, Lord, help us to not forget his redemption. That your incarnation in Bethlehem was just the first step in your reach down into the muck and the mire of human history to form something new and wondrous, to save us from ourselves and from the evil one who controls this world. So help us, Lord, to be mindful of how lucky we are to be redeemed and how good you are to redeem each of us in and through Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.